Now, the second part of this lecture that now we need to model, if we have to model all these adder circuits or adder-like circuits, then how do we model? So far in Verilog, we understand how to instantiate gates, how to use primary gates, how to use data flow modeling, how to use structural modeling, how to connect gates from each other. Now, what additional concept would be required here? The most important concept which would be required here, that we have to use arrays or we have to use bit vectors. So that means more than one bit we need to require as a input as well as an output. So how to handle those bit vectors, so that I'll quickly spend some time. Now, this multiple bit width, first thing is declaration. So in declaration, we can define like a regular wires and registers. So here, whenever we are defining wire, in the square bracket, we write what is the bit width. So we write what is the high number of the bit and this is the low bit. So whatever we are writing here will become most significant bit. Whatever we are writing here, it becomes zero, least significant bit. So when we are writing like this, 3:0, that means it's a 4-bit wide signal A and B. So we can, if we want to define this 4-bit, we can have multiple of signals, all of them would be 4-bit wide. Similarly, I want to define something which is 16-bit wide, then I can say square bracket 15:0. And this A1, A2, A3, A4 are the standard wires. So basically when we are not writing anything in the square bracket, that's what we have been doing in our previous Verilog assignments. There, the default size of my variable is single bit. So they're all single bit variables. But if we put this square bracket and put this colon, that means it's a bit vector. Or we can call it a bus also. So generically, so instead of wire, there could be reg also. This register, this type could be interchangeably used for the declaration. So in general, we are saying that this is the MSB, this is the LSB, least significant bit, this is the most significant bit. So then there could be question, can I define it like 0:3? Yes, you can define it, but in that case, the 0 would be treated, so the 0th bit would be the most significant bit, while the whatever is written here, that is the least significant bit. The pattern would still remain same. Okay, so now if I have these multiple bits and I want to use only certain bits out of that, how do we do that? So for example, here A is my 4-bit signal and my sum is 16-bit. Out of the 16-bit, I want to select only some certain 4 bits. So what I can do is I can say, for example, 12 to 15 of this sum I would like to assign to A. So I can say A equal to sum 15:12. Now again, remember the same thing. So if I want to assign a 0th bit of A to 15th bit of sum, and a first bit of A is equal to 14th bit, so then I can reverse, I can write it in interchangeable manner. I can write sum square bracket 12:15. So 12 will become most significant and 15 will become least significant, and that would be assigned 1:1 to this left hand side variable. So if I want to take only single bit out of it, so let's say this T is a single bit wire, then I can say any particular signal, so let's say 15, so 15th bit of sum would be assigned to A. If two signals are of same size, then no such square bit specification is required. So we can simply say A equal to B. Now A and B both are 4-bit wide signals. So A could be assigned to B without writing anything in the square bracket. So this is how we can do port selection. There is a reverse operation also, that we can concatenate. So you see from the previous declaration, A1, A2, A3, A4, all of them were wires. Now if I want to assign, I want to group them together as a 4-bit signal, so I can put a square bracket, put a curly braces, and put them, curly braces is actually concatenation operator. So in square break, in this curly braces plus with these commas, whatever we write, that would get combined. So when we are writing A4, A3, A2, A1, all of them get combined to become A. So here, most significant bit would be the first bit which we have written here, and least significant is the one which we have written in the end. So this concatenation operation can also be applicable in other ways, where we can say something like this. So I want to initialize, I want to say that this pattern has to be repeated again and again. So this is a 1B1, so that means a 1 bit with value of 1. I want to repeat it 16 times. So then also I can use catenation operator, where I am saying that 16 times repeat this particular pattern. So this can be generically applicable. So instead of this, there could be a variable name also, or a signal name also. So for example, here I can also say sum is equal to 4 times A4, 4 times A3, then 4 times A2, then 4 times A1. So whatever is the value of A1, whether it is 0 or 1, it would be repeated 4 times. So that's how this catenation operator would also be required whenever we are handling this multiple bit width signals. Now let's also quickly see how to write constants when the size of bits is more. So we have seen earlier, so if we are writing for single bit, we have to write 1B and then apostrophe and then value. So if I want to write 4 bit, A is my 4 bit signal, so I can write 4 apostrophe B. Okay, so 4 apostrophe B, and then I can write 0001. So similarly, if instead of binary I want to write in hexadecimal, then instead of B I can write H, then I can say 16 apostrophe H, and then whatever hex number I would like to assign, I can write, because sum is a 16 bit number, so I have to write this 16. So what would happen if left hand side bits and right hand side bits, they don't match? So then if my left hand side is less, then the rest of the bits would be assumed as 0. If this is more, then the bits which are in the higher significant here would be ignored. Okay, so what about display? So if I want to display, then we can use in C, C++, we use the similar modifying operators can be used here. So I can use percentage D for decimal, percentage B for binary, and percentage H for hex. So for example, here I want to display A in binary, I want to display B in binary, and I want to display sum in hex. So I can write correspondingly percentage B, percentage B, percentage at X, H, etc. So another Verilog construct which would be very helpful would be a generate statement. So in the generate statement, what we do, we instantiate a group of statements multiple times using some sort of a for loop. So it can be used in data flow as well as in a structural way. So the generate statements are very much like a C macros. That means it has to be resolvable at compile time. So that means we have to give some constant values here, and it would be inflated means it would be unrolled, or it would be at before your execution, before your compilation. So for example, so whenever we are using this generate statement, so there would be two constructs which are constructs which are important. One is genVar. So genVar is the variable which would be the loop iterator, and there would be a generate statement, and within the generate statement usually there would be a for loop. So in this for loop, I can say for I equal to 0, I less than n, I equal to I plus 1. So this I is a generate variable. So this variable would be fixed wherever in this for loop I would be there, and all these instances would be created. So for example, in this example, what I want to create is, I want to create an N input XOR gate. So because in each XOR gate, I am saying that out I, and input 1 I, input 2i, so that means there would be n number of such gates would be generated, and n has to be a constant, it has to be a fixed constant, so that I can do a compile time analysis, I can generate it at compile time. So using this, now there you can also see that after this for we are saying begin, and this end is for this begin. So this for loop has a begin, so this is the end for this for loop, and now for generate we have to finish it as a end generate. So this is generate block. In this generate block, whatever is there inside, it will get replicated at the elaboration time or at the execution time, it would be elaborated. So that means when we are doing this, it is still generating things structurally. There would be n number of XOR gates that we'll be able to see in our VCD files, or so in our hierarchy also we can see that there are n XOR gates, and each of these XOR gate would be taking different input based on this genware I. So this is more effective method sometime to write a circuit where the circuit looks very similar. So for example, in the ripple carry adder, we have to use n different single bit adders which has very similar definitions, so we can use such kind of a construct if we like. So with this, we would like to close today's lecture. In summary, we have seen how to design adders, we have also analyzed the adders, how the delay is, why, or how to compute delays and how to optimize delays. So all this, with this analysis, we can also use this kind of analysis in other circuits also, in a similar circuits also. And along with that, we have also seen how to write Verilog with bit vector as a in the programs. Thank you very much.